Of all the energy sources currently in use on planet Earth, none have such a long history or deep controversy as coal. As one of the earliest sources of energy, coal has proved to be a reliable performer over time, but carries some concerns when it comes to air pollution and climate change. As economist Thomas Sowell put it, there are no solutions, there are only trade-offs. And so when it comes to producing the electricity that we all enjoy as a part of our modern lifestyle, is the trade-off of coal sustainable? How much of the electricity generated today is powered by coal, and will it ever become obsolete? We seek to answer these questions and more on today's episode of Commodity Culture. Coal begins its life as a giant plant in a prehistoric swamp, hundreds of millions of years ago, before even the mighty dinosaur roamed the earth. As that plant and many others around it dies and becomes submerged in the swampy environment, geological forces subject them to heat and pressure over time. This causes the dead plant matter to transform. What began as a moist and low-carbon form of peat is now energy and carbon-dense coal, and a sort of life and death cycle has taken place. From living plants to dead plant matter, and then into an energy-rich rock that is at the heart of humanity's rapid technological progress over the ages. Now, depending on how much time has passed since the swampy peat matter began its metamorphosis, it will have turned into one of four different categories of coal. Lignite contains 25 to 35% carbon and is the least energy-dense form of coal. It is a crumbly substance and is high in moisture, so has a suboptimal heating value. It is mostly used to generate electricity, but it can also be converted into a form of synthetic natural gas, chemically similar in most respects to the real thing, and so can be substituted or used interchangeably. Sub-bituminous coal bumps the carbon up a notch, with a 35 to 45% quantity. The average age of this variety of coal is at least 100 million years old, but averages a very elderly 251 million years of age. The last note I'll make on sub-bituminous is that it's also mostly used for electricity generation. Bituminous coal starts to really bring the carbon, with a density of 45 to 86%. This is the main form of coal produced in the U.S., accounting for approximately 48% of U.S. coal production as of 2019. In addition to following in its siblings' footsteps and being used for electricity, it also is a raw material for making the fifth category of coal, which doesn't exist naturally, called coking coal. Coking coal is made use of as a fuel and a reducing agent in smelting iron ore in a blast furnace. Anthracite contains 86 to 97% carbon and has the highest heating value amongst all ranks of coal, and is also smokeless and pollutes the least. It is mainly used for metallurgical purposes, but also finds some use as a heating fuel. All the varieties of coal contain sulfur in varying degrees, which releases toxins into the air when burned. Interestingly, the sulfur content is dictated by the environmental conditions in which the coal was created. Freshwater environments breed low sulfur coal, while brackish swamps and marine-influenced environments produce a high sulfur variety. Coal, like all fossil fuels, is composed of carbon and hydrogen. When combusted, the carbon forms harmful carbon dioxide and the hydrogen becomes water. Coal has a greater quantity of carbon than, say, oil or natural gas, and so causes more damage to the environment overall. When we trace the history of coal mining back from when it was first brought out of the earth until today, a lot of people had to give their lives to pave the way for energy generation, making it one of the more dangerous professions over the ages. In fact, from 1900 to 2020, an estimated 104,895 people perished while mining coal in the U.S. alone, according to the United States Department of Labor. But considering that archaeological evidence after approximately 3490 BC shows early surface coal mining in China, the number of lives lost worldwide throughout history is undoubtedly a far bigger number. In the first underground coal mines, miners toiled with primitive pickaxes and only a meager candle to light the area. The candle also proved dangerous, however, as it could cause pockets of methane gas trapped in the earth, referred to as fire damp, to ignite and explode, bringing certain death to any miner in the vicinity of the blast. Choke damp was another major concern, a form of stale air that could suffocate miners to death. Add to that the potential risk of flooding, which can and did happen regularly, and we can see that it was sometimes a roll of the dice for miners on a daily basis to determine if they lived or died. It was also very common to be in a permanent state of strain and injury from toiling with such heavy weight through awkwardly spaced mining shafts, so overall, life kinda sucked for early era miners. Now, it wasn't just the men that risked their lives, women and children had some of the worst of it, being forced to crawl on their hands and knees in tight areas of almost total blackness with a rope tied around their bodies from which they dragged extremely heavy carts of recently mined coal. They got this job because they were smaller in stature and more easily able to fit in the various crevices of the mine, but they sometimes never saw daylight at all except on Sundays, as they were underground from before sunrise to after sundown. In 1842, the Mines and Collieries Act was passed in the United Kingdom, which forbade women of any age and boys under the age of 10 from working in a mine. This came to pass after a mining accident caused by steam overflow due to violent thunderstorms left 26 children dead at a mine in the UK. Now, the initial solution to the problem of explosive gas was a special class of miners called firemen, who wrapped themselves in protective clothing and took shelter under panels of wood before purposefully igniting trapped gases with a long torch or a candle drawn on a string. They needed to do this multiple times per day to ensure the mine shafts were kept clear of explosive gases while the miners extracted coal. To say this job was stressful would be an understatement indeed. The coking of coal was first implemented in 1740 for the smelting of iron, and this made it much more economically feasible to produce it, resulting in a boom for the iron industry. The iron created by coking coal was then used to build more effective implements and technology to mine more coal. Modern coal mining has come a long way and consists mainly of three methods. Continuous mining employs remote-controlled, monstrous machines with foot-long teeth called continuous miners to break through the earth and extract the coal. These devices can extract as much coal in 1 minute as used to take an entire day back in the 1920s. Longwall mining was first introduced in the late 1950s and has evolved a lot since that time. Like continuous mining, longwall relies on special machinery. Now, it's a little tough to explain, so here's a definition from the Dictionary of Energy. A mining method in which very long rectangular blocks of coal are defined during the development stage of the mine and then extracted in a single continuous operation by an automated cutting head moving parallel to the coal face. Surface mining became a viable method following World War II, and eliminated a lot of the risks associated with underground mining by once again employing huge machines, but this time to strip away earth and reveal coal seams that lie closer to the surface. These machines, called dragline excavators, are considered the world's largest land-based machines and are a spectacular sight to behold. Surface mining is done in large open areas of land where coal seams can be readily identified that don't require going deep underground to uncover. In the days of ancient Greece, the great philosopher Aristotle described a rock that burns. Today, we know that rock as coal. Coal was used by many ancient civilizations. The Roman Empire, the Hopi Indians in early America, and the Chinese, to name a few. It was mainly used as a source of heat, but was also employed in baking pottery and the burning of funeral pyres. As early as 1215, sea coal began to be traded around Scotland and the northeast of England, where it was used by artisans for lime burning, metalworking, and smelting. Sea coal was often washed ashore from deposits below sea level and collected by hand to be traded. As forests were stripped bare of wood for heating and the construction of ships, the use of coal became a necessity, and so a quest began to mine it in earnest. If you think air pollution is bad in some parts of the world nowadays, as coal rose to prominence in towns and cities back then, it produced a black smog so dense that entire neighborhoods were sometimes enveloped, making it impossible to see clearly. Visibility turned out to be the least of people's worries, however, as inhaling such vast amounts of coal smoke killed many citizens before efforts were made to reduce and clean up its use. In fact, as recently as the 1950s, there were public health disasters resulting from the burning of coal, and the Great Smog of London swept over its namesake city in 1952, primarily driven by coal use. The government reported 4,000 deaths officially, but I've learned enough about how governments operate to place far more trust in the more recent research that indicates 10 to 12,000 civilian deaths from the killer clouds of coal dust. This crisis, and many others over the ages since coal came into regular use in the 13th century, led to the Clean Air Act of 1956. The act was enacted by the Parliament of the United Kingdom as a means of protecting the citizens from coal dust and other toxic particles in the air by mandating smokeless fuels such as charcoal, and included measures to reduce emissions of dust, grit, and gases from chimneys. The Industrial Revolution, spurred on by improvements in technology, brought about a massive increase in the amount of coal being mined, with production growing rapidly in response to this new demand. Coal was indeed king when it came to this era, and continued to reign in the Western world for a long time to come. British poet William Blake famously described coal-powered cotton mills as dark, satanic mills, and indeed the constant churning of smoke and layer of black soot on everything must have given many areas of England a dreary and intimidating atmosphere. Nonetheless, there was no other substance that could produce energy as efficiently or as cheaply as coal, and it powered not only the means of production, but also transportation. Great imposing steamships and sturdy railway locomotives were powered with great success, especially considering the existing technology of the time. It also fueled engines that drained water from coal mines, contributing to another full circle journey for the black rock, as it was turned into steam to power the engines and allow miners to travel even deeper into the earth, thus increasing their total haul of coal. Coal has provided a large amount of total energy production in the UK over the years, and even though its use fell from 156.89 million metric tons in 1970, all the way down to 900,000 metric tons in 2019, it still remains a large source of power, accounting for approximately 9% of total energy consumption in the United Kingdom. We've been focusing quite a bit on the UK because they have a longer recorded history of coal use than pretty much any other European country. But coal was, and continues to be, a large source of energy in the developing world. And despite all the hate it gets, it is still a necessary piece of the overall energy picture if we ever hope to get to a carbon neutral future. This is because to upgrade to a technology like nuclear power, which is the most cost-effective and efficient low-carbon source of energy on planet Earth at present, developing nations need to climb the energy ladder and evolve their energy production by improving their country's economic situation before they can afford to shift to a less environmentally harmful energy source. As of 2019, the top consumer of coal was China, although they are currently striving very hard to advance nuclear, wind, and solar energy production. With plans to reduce the CO2 intensity of its gross domestic product by 60% by the year 2030. President Xi has committed to reduce coal consumption starting in 2026, but many other countries do not have that option if they want to have access to electricity in the years ahead. A recent two-day virtual summit on tackling climate change, hosted by the White House and involving all the countries who have agreed to the Paris Climate Agreement, has placed a big emphasis on a global shift towards carbon-neutral energy production. With an ambitious and some would say lofty goal of limiting global warming to well below 2 degrees Celsius, phasing out of using coal is a key part of achieving that goal. As civilization moves forward, there will come a time when coal will be just a fleeting memory. But for now, it still has a role to play in our global energy economy. Thanks for watching Commodity Culture, and see you next time. Commodity Culture is a series that covers the history and culture surrounding commodities and natural resources. If you enjoyed this episode and want to see more, please subscribe and hit the bell notification to ensure you are always alerted of the latest episodes.